earliest memories are from my grandmother's kitchen in Puerto Rico, watching her make arroz con gandules and tembleque. Meals have a way of bringing us joy. They fuel our bodies and feed our souls. I'm Aixa Diaz. Come with us across the country as we show you what stitches us together, and in this case, it's food. First, we're off to Des Moines, Iowa, where families in need are finding generosity and a taste of home. Here's KCCI's Rhea Spigner.
This is what we're giving out, and then if we have to go into reserves, we'll go into reserves.
Zuli Garcia is the centerpiece to make it all happen.
I started this food pantry December 24th of 2020, and it was during the pandemic, right? Who starts something during a pandemic? Everybody was like, no, not us, but I was like, yeah, me.
Todas estas refres, everybody ayuda.
Yes, her. What started as an idea to gather donations and drop off food to families in need turned into Latino Knock and Drop, a busy operation and pantry catered specifically to the Latino community, serving thousands.
Beans, frijoles, arroz, jalapeños, tomate, cebolla. I eat beans, I eat huevos, you know, I eat rice. And so why do we need to force them to eat what you want them to eat? When I moved here 25 years ago, I was always helping others and making sure, because that's something my dad and my mom taught me, is to make sure that you help others that are in need, especially our community, because of the language barrier.
Garcia is breaking through more than a language barrier. This place provides comfort beyond food.
My community actually needs it, because there's people out there that need the food and they're being denied food. Just a couple weeks ago, I had a lady come in here and she would not grab the food because she thought we would report her somewhere.
A safe space. Support from nonprofits and grants for families have allowed for Zuli to provide fresh food, a hot meal, and more, while bringing in local vendors, too.
We open it to anyone. If you love our food, you're more than welcome to come get it. Y para la comunidad latina que nos está escuchando a donde estén, this place is a safe place, and it's open for everyone.
That same spirit of giving back is what drives one Iowa mother to help people facing food insecurity in her community.
Monica Ovcharski is a mom of three and runs Sweet Tooth Farm Des Moines right on the side of her house.
We hold a farm stand right here on 8th Street in Riverbend every Wednesday, all summer and fall. And we think it's really important to hold the farm stand here in the neighborhood.
All the produce from a community garden she manages with her family, filling holes of food insecurity and planting knowledge. Monica has a passion to feed her community.
It's really magical to watch third graders fight over carrots. This, you know, if I know we are in Iowa and we are a very, very rural and ag state, but you know, not everyone has a grandpa or uncle who has a farm, and not everybody has those experiences where they get to see a big garden.
But they can on 8th Street, and now a big fridge sits in front of this big garden, running on courage and Monica's electricity, full of fresh produce and good food for anyone who needs it.
Billy Weathers here in the neighborhood, Austin Neal, Zakaria Hill. There's other leaders in the community who saw this gap, but I think it can be really empowering to realize that if people just come together and use their collective power, they really can get things done.
The how is one part people wanting to make a difference, like Monica, and an organization like Eat Greater Des Moines, who not only provided the fridge through a grant, but committed to dropping off food several days every week.
We've got a couple different meat products down here. There's some rice, potatoes, some salami, there's some tofu.
For anyone, no questions asked, no photos taken. A fridge in the heart of Des Moines, always open.
Now we meet an Iowa couple hosting a bed and breakfast with a twist. Here's Rhea again with their story.
Just outside of Clarksville is a quaint little getaway, something in between a bed and breakfast and a vacation rental. But little do you know, once you step into those doors, you step back out into farm life.
To this cute bed and breakfast New Day Dairy Farm that not only gives you a quiet space, but the full farm experience, run by a city girl from Minnesota and a generational farmer, Lynn and Dan.
We don't know of any other farms in the Midwest or in the United States that have something like the 24/7 cow gazing.
Through some beautiful bay windows on the second floor to a sea of cows.
Dan actually knows pretty much all 120 of them just by looking at them, which is incredible, but that's what he does.
A handful of Holsteins are displayed inside too, hand-painted by Lynn's mother.
So we got to see the cows up close, maybe feed them a little grass, get a few cow pets, and then see Rita the robot milking them on their introductory tour. And then before they leave, I always take them on a farewell tour, and that's out to see the calves, get to, you know, see where they live. And then in between that, some people will choose to add on the Be a Dairy Farmer Challenge Tour.
And if you dare, for an entire day, you can take on the task of being a farmer. So naturally, that's what I did.
No swagger. Into the tractor. But I made it.
Yay! We've got some chores to cover.
It's like a circus around here.
Woo!
Yeah. Tractors don't have great suspension.
And before I have any tasks with the cows, of course, I need to get to know them.
Kiwi, 32, the unicorn, mm-hmm. They all came from Minnesota. So there's a few that have been bought in.
Each cow has the same letter as their mom cow, grandma cow, great-grandma cow.
But then some, like Jing, goes way back to a heifer I got mid-90s, early 90s.
Passing down a legacy of J's, or R's, or L's, or news, like New Day, the cow.
New Day, oh yeah, this is New Day herself. She is the cow of the painting.
And Dan is holding down a legacy of his own.
Both of my grandpas then put equity and things on the line. So this is really not just Dan and Lynn. This is all kinds of generations.
Absolutely.
And some days it's a weighty burden, but it's also a blessing.
One he hopes to pass down to his kiddos. This dairy farm that is truly a well-oiled machine. And knowing every cow is an art.
Hey, how you doing?
They know their spot around the barn, and although these are some friendly cows, fetch the cow to get her milk. Thought I would be sitting on a stool until I was hit with a remix and met Rita, the milking robot.
Here it is. This is all it takes to milk a cow automatically. Every visit, every cow, how much milk, then waits in the stainless receiver jar, and then pumped over into the other room, gets cooled down.
But I'm in a challenge for the day.
Oh, man. The moment of truth.
So, of course, it's not going to come that easily for me.
Yeah, just like that.
Okay.
This feels so weird. I feel like I'm hurting her, but I know I'm not.
No, just...
Okay. Ooh, it's warm.
Yes.
Okay.
Did not do a good job.
All right, I'm gonna do it better.
Get in here.
Ah! Ha-ha! I did it!
The rest of the day went a little easier with my chores. From fresh manure to a fresh calf, 7 hours old.
Wow. You look pretty amazing all dried off, girl.
Hey, cutie.
You are something different.
Any guest staying gets to name a new calf, so I got to name this one from an L family.
Are you living up to your name, funny girl?
LOL seemed suitable.
Okay.
You want any more LOL? You good, girl?
Okay, that wasn't the easiest either.
Ooh, you got teeth.
This was truly a full farmer experience for this city girl and a day that I'll never forget. If I was staying over, we would have wrapped up with a dairy dinner.
Most all of us enjoy ice cream, cheese and crackers, cottage cheese, yogurt, all of those dairy products. And this kind of gives that little bit closer experience with where that food actually comes from. It's not just out of the, you know, refrigerator at the grocery store.
A full circle experience.
Coming up, a family restaurant celebrating 100 years and the item on the menu known as the Italian penicillin. Welcome back. Italian food is a crowd pleaser, and one California family takes their recipes seriously. They're carrying on their matriarch's labor of love 100 years later. Here's KCRA's Will Hereford.
My grandmother, born Teresa Maria Antonio Bassagnani Vinciguerra Germani Fajato, was born in 1895 in Tuscany and came to this country when she was 16.
And on Jackson Gate Road, she opened a place for hungry and tired miners to eat and sleep.
And it's been in the same family continuously for the last 100 years.
Now the namesake's four grandchildren serve her recipes to loyal customers.
This is a picture of our grandma with us when we were children. There's four of us in 4.5 years.
All the grandkids and some of their kids have their special jobs here. The four siblings live walking distance to the restaurant, and of course, they get along.
Well, we call it our work a hobby, but it's really a labor of love, and we feel fortunate that we have this legacy. I think we feel like we're the caretakers of the restaurant.
But it's not just the family harmony that keeps customers coming back. It's the atmosphere and food.
My comfort food is homemade lasagna and eggplant parmesan, but the minestrone soup we're famous for, my grandmother called it Italian penicillin. Whatever ailed you, have some minestrone soup.
Oh, it's a great place, I'll tell you. I think I've been coming here for about 99 out of 100, but no, it's a great place. We've been here for a long time, enjoyed the family. They're just a great asset to this community. They really are.
Here you can have practically any Italian dish. They want you to feel like you're at home.
When people come in, we want them to feel like, you know, the hominess of the place and feel like they would at their own house, you know, comfortable.
And here there are traditions like nicknames for regulars and this.
People started putting coins in there and then it went to paper money.
They call it their Italian wishing wall, and each year the money stuck in the cracks is gathered up and given to charity. Here the history is served piping hot, and it's also on display through their actions, like what their family motto says.
Hard work, a passion for what we do, and respect for family.
Sempre avanti.
What does that mean?
Always forward.
That's what our grandfather said.
And here's to 100 more. Congrats. Some restaurants don't stay in one place for very long because they have wheels. Brittany Hope shows us food trucks sharing authentic bites with their community.
We're doing the trio tacos.
Order number 75.
So I was like, you know what, let's call it a web. I was like, I've always loved when I hear that word in the kitchen, which is kind of, yeah, slang for like, hell yeah. So I like, let's call it a huevo, and I always like adding the egg to everything, so it kind of breaks, you know, wordplay, like a huevo or a huevo.
Meet Giovanni and Maria Gioffo, the owners of A Huevo Foods. Born and raised in South San Francisco, the couple moved to Sacramento and took a leap of faith for their family.
We wanted something special, something that you couldn't get anywhere else.
Opening up their own food truck with a unique specialty.
It's called Lomo Saltado, which means sauteed steak. And it's a steak with onions and tomatoes and like a soy sauce. So it's like a Peruvian dish.
Peruvian-Mexican fusion.
As much as, you know, this is my wife, she's also like my best friend.
Serving dishes, a marriage of their own cultures.
I'm actually Peruvian Salvadoran. I personally didn't really know authentic Mexican food until I met her and her family.
Yeah.
And that's when I was like blown away on how big and deep Mexican food is.
Since the couple opened up shop in 2016, they say it's been important for them to share their heritage with each other and with neighbors.
I've gotten customers tell me that too, like, man, thank you for that. You know, you took me back being a kid. You took me back, you know, going to my grandma's house. And that's one of the things that we love about food is that you can time travel based off a smell, off a dish, off a taste.
Sharing something new with people who haven't met them or their culture's dishes before, creating connections with each bite.
You have a chance to show people a part of you that, you know, it's authentic to you. And it's something you grew up with, that's something that you're proud of. And I feel like it's something that, it's a privilege, I feel. It's not easy, but it's worth it for sure.
If you're not hungry yet, here's more. Brittany checks out a different food truck with a taste of Argentina.
There you go, my friend.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
It was something that I grew up with.
Ulises Lispade was born and raised in Argentina.
Ham and cheese and chorizo. All right, it's going to be 1088. The name of my business is Chester Braniz. And we make Argentinian empanadas.
4 years ago, he started selling empanadas from a pop-up tent. Now he has two food trucks in Sacramento.
When you put ingredients, especially when you put the ingredients and it brings you back like the smell, you know, when I was a kid, and that I love it. One, two, and three. Beef, chicken, and chorizo, that's the favorite order.
He says his Latino community helped spread word of his business.
In a day, we usually go between 400 and 500 empanadas.
With the dough imported from Argentina, he marks every single empanada with a number and his label.
So the number is the flavor identifier.
On the side is always a container of his homemade chimichurri sauce.
There are different ways to make it. You have, you know, 40 million people in Argentina. There are probably 40 million different recipes of chimichurri.
Les Pares says sharing the diversity of his home country with people in Northern California is important to him.
You can taste love in food. You can taste joy in food. You can taste the emotion in food, and they're really good.
This Hispanic Heritage Month, he says he is reflecting on his journey so far, thanking his community and family, and working to make a difference, one empanada at a time. The power of food bringing us together.
It gives you a sense of accomplishment when you bring something that is yours, and it's just an idea, and it becomes into something real.
Coming up, teaching valuable lessons through food. Stay with us. Welcome back. Let's go to Central Florida, where one high school is giving back without leaving campus. Here's WESH 2's Sana Gadange.
It's a fresh take on nutrition at Olympia High School in Orange County, where students leave for the day with more than just homework and books. Once a month, student volunteers help sort, organize, and distribute produce for both students and faculty in need, provided by Second Harvest Food Bank.
People can come and pick what they'd like. That way, it's a more personalized experience.
This fresh market is part of something bigger at Olympia, the Titan Market.
Anybody can come through the window to get snacks. Anybody can come through the door and kind of get anything that they'd like. We're not ever asking any personal questions, like your name, anything like that. You can just come in, take whatever you need.
The number one item, peanut butter. But students can also take home things to make meals for themselves and their families.
The pastas, like with rice and the noodles and all that type of stuff, and our mac and cheese, all of that stuff goes pretty fast.
Senior Devin Clancy is in charge of marketing the market on campus. He's been with the program at Olympia High School since its inception 3 years ago, after his mom, also a teacher, fought to bring the Titan Market on campus.
We have so many kids that are in need, and food scarcity is just not just a national issue, but an international issue. And so I thought it was a great opportunity for the students to be a part of solving a problem that we're all dealing with.
How many people in your household? 18.
One in five kids in Central Florida is at risk of going to bed hungry. The Titan Market is helping ease that burden. It's also teaching the students. Ms. Clancy's seventh period research class is dedicated to the management and operation of the Titan Market.
Any members?
But a bigger lesson is playing out too.
A lot of times people don't really think about like food in the sense, especially when it comes to teenagers. A big thing that we've always trying to get rid of is the stigma behind asking for help. My parents especially didn't come from a very easy background. They kind of struggled a lot in life. So just hearing those stories all throughout kind of caused me to try to help people.
A lot of us are like, could be caught up in our own little bubbles, in our own little worlds. But if we take a moment to look outside of our little worlds and see all that is going on, we can see that it's not all perfect, and that you can help a whole lot of people by just doing a small thing.
A fresh market that distributes food with the heaping help of hope.
We all have a favorite restaurant that we go to over and over, but what if that place was in trouble? WESH 2's Claire Metz shows us how one Central Florida customer stepped up to save her favorite beach diner.
The Beacon Restaurant lives up to its name here on Flagler Avenue, a true focal point in this tight-knit community. The owners have been dishing it up for more than 40 years.
The worst call you could ever get in your life, you know, scariest moment, you know, somebody calling you screaming, your restaurant's on fire.
George Katsanis and his extended family survived the pandemic, holding onto the restaurant and staff. Then, just as things were getting back to normal, fire broke out in the kitchen. It was after hours, no one was hurt, but the damage was extensive. The business is insured, however.
Everything's just taking a lot of time with the insurance, you know, sending quotes, waiting for acceptance, this and that and stuff. stuff. So, you know, it's just been tough. We've just been trying to do what we can, you know, on our own to just clean up as much as we can.
Everyone grew up going to it. The family that owns it is just so welcoming.
Resident, loyal customer, and food blogger Mackenzie Smith wanted to help and put out a request on her popular Instagram page.
I know times are tough, and I know a lot of people don't have a lot of money right now. But if you could give $1 or $2.
In 24 hours, followers donated more than $20,000 to the restaurant's cause, sharing stories of their Beacon memories.
So many people are like, I needed to see something like this happen because everything's just been so hard this year and last year.
The owners didn't ask for the help, but they are so grateful. It may let them recover sooner, keep employees paid.
It's just, you know, breathtaking, you know, brought tears to all our eyes. You know, we just can't believe there was that much love around.
Now let's head to Oklahoma City. KOCO's Mecca Rain shows us how one community is taking care of one another by sharing food.
It's open 24/7. Anyone can access it at any time.
Community taking care of the community. The historic Britton Road District finding itself in the spotlight as new businesses open up shop.
I call this Dreamland because, you know, I come here every day, I make coffee, I make people happy, and I feel like I'm doing something for the community in terms of, you know, taking this vacant lot and turning it into something, like I said, that can build a community.
Vic is the owner of Brew Brothers Coffee. The little shop calls Owl Court home. That's also where the Britton Road Community Fridge and Pantry are now open for business.
The Britton Road Community Fridge is really just a space where community members can take care of each other.
Jada Lorenz is spearheading this project. She says the fridge and pantry will serve the community with the help of the community.
I think it's just really important for a community to have avenues that they can take to make sure that everyone in the community is cared for.
Loren says there are no income requirements. It's open for anyone in need.
Community members are encouraged to bring any food surplus in their homes. It's open 24/7. Anyone can access it at any time. And also we will be doing a fridge restock probably once a week through donations made to our Venmo.
Oklahoma City is also doing its part helping seniors who can't leave their homes. Kylie Thomas shows us how volunteers are feeding thousands of seniors every day.
600 meals every day go out this door from St. Luke's, helping seniors across the county get meals they otherwise wouldn't.
You do not need to return my call. I just wanted to let you know that a few days ago, some of your people brought this huge, heavy box of food and goodies to us from the Meals on Wheels group, and it was just, the only word I can use is amazing. It was like Christmas right then.
Well, you know, it truly touches your heart because, you know, we take food pretty for granted.
Throughout the year, St. Luke's and 50 other area churches have served and delivered over 5.5 million hot meals during a time when seniors weren't able to leave their home.
The need has always been there, but through the pandemic, I think we've become a lot more aware of it. Sometimes they take that very meal and they only eat a portion of it so they can have some now and some later. So missing that, not delivering that, can be really difficult for some people.
St. Luke says the need is evident and continues to grow.
Meals on Wheels.
Volunteers delivering batch after batch to homebound seniors.
Good morning, Mr. May. How are
18, you? 18,000 a day. But it's more than just a meal. It's a friendly face checking in when the world is far apart.
We think it's just fundamentally important and a part of our DNA of just sharing God's love, bringing hope to the world, and it can be done as simply as a meal.
We hope you enjoyed these uplifting stories of communities coming together through food. I'm Aixa Diaz. From all of us here at Stitch, thanks for watching. See you next time.